So sometimes the product would be really great, right? A lot of features, it's within the price point. It is readily available. There's a lot of the target audiences are rich enough to get it. But then what would happen is that the perception of the product might not be as good among the customers as the manufacturers expect it to be, right? So talking about consumer perception, I'd like to talk about this one one saying by David Ogilvy, who is considered as the father of advertising. So so he said that the consumer is not a moron. She is your wife, right? And he has explained that if you try to insult her intelligence with just some shiny advertising and catchy key phrases, it would backfire on you, right? Because what would really matter from a consumer perspective is that the consumer must feel a belonging to the product, right? The consumer must feel that, okay, this is the car that I'm looking for, or I need this mobile, this mobile completes me, right? So that kind of feeling has to come from within the customer, right? So what might be the causes of consumer perceptions, right? So, or basically, what is consumer perception? People think about brand. Some people say that, I would buy only a Honda car because Honda engines are good, right? Some people would say that, and I'm sure that at least 40% of the people would agree here when I say that iPhone is the best phone available in the market. Right, 40% seems to be a little too high. Or some of you guys have already started sleeping. Sorry guys. So anyways, so sometimes there's this brand value, brand loyalty, all these concepts comes into play when it comes to when we talk about consumer perception, right? So interestingly, so there's this product called JCB that is used when you're making like roads and all this excavation kind of thing, right? So JCB is essentially the name of the brand that makes it, one brand that makes that product. But then we all associate that name JCB to the product itself that most of us does not even know what the product actually is, okay? So similarly for the car company Jeep, right? We all, until recently, we all thought that Jeep is just that class of vehicles in which police comes and grabs you once you've done some kind of bad thing. But then Jeep was actually a brand, right? So these kind of perceptions affect. So about these perceptions of consumers, it could be true. Sometimes it is like consumers are very spot on in finding out something. It would be true. It could be misunderstood feature, right? Because the manufacturer expected it to be a certain feature that works in a certain way, but then the consumers think that, hey, that is not exactly what I want. It could be a hoax, right? Probably something that a competitor has created, or probably it's a misconception, right? So there are two key ways in which all these consumer perceptions travel around. You can always make your own consumer perceptions, but then there's like two other key ways. One is through social media, and one is through the oldest way, word of mouth, right? So how do you think that consumer perception can affect a product? Right? It's very basic, very simple, straightforward. If the perception on a product is bad, that would fail. If the perception on a product is successful, it would succeed, right? Very straight. So essentially, consumer perceptions can either make or break a product. So that is why all the product manufacturers, before they start their process, or once they're going to make a next release of their product or a next version, right? So what they do something called qualitative research, right? They talk to people, they interview people individually, they have discussions with people, they try to get surveys and feedback from past users or potential users, or people who could have potentially been using a competitor software, right? So the market researchers contacts all these kinds of people and tries to figure out if they can gather some insights about what is the general feeling about the product is. There's always this another side of it called the quantitative research, where they talk about how many units were sold, what were the sales by, say, this volume, these channels. That's the quantitative side. This is the qualitative side, which talks about what worked, what did not work, what could be improved, what would have made this a runaway success, right? So that is the concept of qualitative research. So there are, like I said, there are many qualitative research methodologies, interviews, discussions, all those things. And one very key or very very popular method of qualitative research is called a focus group discussion or a focus group interview, right? So in a focus group discussion, what happens is product manufacturers, like product designers, product owners, right? They call up a couple of people, right? These couple of people are chosen from a larger sample set containing the users of a past version of the product, the brand loyalists of that particular brand, users who could potentially be purchasing one of their future products, users who are using their competitors' products, right? So a wide spectrum of audiences, and not just any audiences, wide spectrum of targeted audiences are obtained, and a focus group discussion is done with all these people. So the concept of focus group discussions is so powerful that Bill Clinton has once described it as the most powerful people in the world are focus groups, because they decide what is the next step of a product is going to be. They decide what is going to be the next wave of a product or a startup or an idea, right? So there are three key components to a focus group analysis discussion, right? So first thing, like I said, is focus. The focus group discussion is supposed to be very focused. If there's a product that we are talking about only that product, right? We don't want to, you know, unnecessarily go into a competitor's data or probably past sales data or all those things, right? We are talking about the features of the product. We are talking about what, like I said before, what worked on the product, what could work on that product, right? What will not work on that product, those kind of things. Secondly, it is targeted, right? It's not like you do a focus group with random people. You do it with very specific very specific individuals who can potentially be converted, right? Who would potentially jump in at a prospect of having this product live, right? Who would be more than willing to pay for and use this particular product once it is released. So that is the second concept of focus group interview. And the third thing is that focus group interviews typically are run by a moderator, right? So the reason behind having a moderator is, there are multiple reasons behind having a moderator. So one thing is that the moderator is a person who knows a bit more about the product, the brand, the business acumen and things. So he can ensure that the discussion remains focused, right? He can ensure that everything happens in accordance with what is expected, right? So he can also facilitate the discussion, right? He can direct it in the right directions to answer the right questions and things like that. He can creatively contribute. So if he sees that the discussion is going in a direction that is not really relevant, or the discussion is missing a point that he wants to address, right? So that is when the moderator can contribute into this particular discussion, right? For instance, let's assume a phone manufacturer, right? Say, for example, I'm saying OnePlus, right? So OnePlus is planning to launch their new phone, right? So they might be holding a focus group with a couple of people, maybe like five people who are using their latest flagship phone, five people who are using maybe an older version, five people who are using an iPhone, five people who are using probably an Oppo phone, right? Maybe five people who are just the social media influencers who posts reviews and all those things about mobile phones, right? So these 25 people are put into a room and given a draft idea, right? So yeah, by the way, there are multiple ways in which focus group discussions can be done. That is up to the moderator, but I'm just explaining a typical scenario, right? So the moderator collects all these people into a room and say that, hey, we are planning to release a new phone. It has 100 megapixel camera, 10,000 mAh battery, and no Bluetooth. Right? Just a random example, right? And no Bluetooth, right? So the people start discussing about it. Some people say that the camera, having a 100 megapixel camera is really good, but then as long as you cannot bring in a wide color range, it is useless. As long as you cannot bring in an HDR component, it is useless. Or probably some people who say that, I think optical zoom, having an optical zoom would be very beneficial, right? And then about the battery life, people would say all sort of things. People would be like, I don't care whether it's 5,000 or 10,000. As long as it lasts me for a whole day, I'm happy, right? Different ways in which people would put their opinion, right? And if at all, if the discussion is going somewhere else, the moderator can always bring it back. Hey guys, I think we missed the Bluetooth point. Can we talk about the Bluetooth? How important is Bluetooth to you, right? The moderator can always bring the discussion back. Now, in addition to doing all of this, the moderator does a very critical, important thing, right? I cannot find enough adjectives to describe it, and that is to observe, right? The moderator observes what is happening in the conversation, right? So he looks at what people are talking about and a whole lot of things. And then he needs to give back a report to the product owner, right? To the product owner saying that, one, would the product be successful or not? Two, if it is not going to be successful, what are the potential things that you could improve to make it successful? Three, what are the general things that people are expecting from the product, right? Four, what is the sentiments about different kind of things in the product, in different kinds of features in the product, right? So a moderator is expected to, you know, very vigilantly, closely observe the situation, ensure that ensure the, all the other three things, and then ensure each and ensure that they capture each and every expressions and things from the user, from the participants of the focus group discussion. Now, when we talk about observe, there are a couple of things that a moderator typically observes. One is around body language, right? So when you talk about something that you're very interested about, your eyes widen, you get like so passionate, energetic, you tend to sit forward in your chair and argue tirelessly, right? So all this minor body language, and also on the contrary, if you're talking about something that you're not very happy about, your expressions might not really be as cheerful as it was in the previous case, right? So all this minor changes in body language is observed by the moderator. The tonality of your voice, right? So the same thing again, that tonality is again subjective because different people talk differently, but still the same thing when a person says it with a lot of you know, excitement, and when a person like says it in an okay tone, it there's a lot of difference usually, right? So those changes in tonality are also captured, and also another place where tonality comes into play is when you're being sarcastic, right? For instance, so someone saying, yeah, right. You know, we clearly know that is sarcasm, right? So those kind of things are given away by the tonality of the participants. Then we have the content, right? So what the people are actually talking about, right? Like for instance, someone saying that the camera with 100 megapixels is not really good, or probably I'm happy with a phone that lasts for one day, whose battery lasts for one day, right? So all these minor points that they make, this is also analyzed by the moderator, right? So we were thinking these are the key things that are being analyzed by the moderator. And like as you have sat in a lot of sessions today, you might have known that machine learning and deep learning has advanced to a phase where we can do all of this. We can do video analysis. We can automate video analysis with machine learning algorithms. We can automate tonality analysis. We cannot always automate sentiment analysis, right? So all these capabilities, all these technical capabilities are there with us now. So why not automate the role of a moderator, right? So the key reasons why are a couple of things. So one is that a moderator, typically a moderator has to be, you know, flown around to different cities to do the focus group discussions, because that again gets clubbed to the next point, that is human bias. So if I do the moderation of a focus group that's happening in Hyderabad, if someone else does it in Bangalore, high chances are that our observations need not converge. Because first of all, observations are a it changes from person to person, right? So I would feel that the third person in the fifth row is sleeping, but then actually he might be thinking, right? So yet another observer from here would be saying that he's chatting with his girlfriend while this discussion is happening, right? So due to that reason, it would be very difficult for multiple moderators to run the focus group for the same product. So that's a logistic challenge. And second thing is human bias, right? If at all you get like two different moderators to do that, again, high chances are that there would be a human bias that is happening, that's coming in. Then there's also this culture thing, right? So culture thing goes either way. So in certain culture, people are like, you know, more expressive in their faces, but their tone is always flat, right? In certain culture, nothing will come in their faces, right? We'll look at them and we wouldn't even be able to figure out if they understood what we said or not. But then their tone would be like very, very expressive, right? So there could be that culture bias. So a moderator who is trained in one certain culture might not really be able to do well in a different culture, right? So that is when we thought about this solution which could automate the process of analyzing focus group discussions. So we had some free time at work. We, as part of our research activities, we tried to build this into a product. And I'll be talking about this particular particular product that we built out during our free time, right? So quick disclaimer, this is not a final perfect product. And one main reason I wanted to present this here is that I wanted to pick your brains as well while this is being presented. Go through it and let's talk after the discussion or during the question answer session. And I would like to hear what it is that you would want as an improvement to this product, or what we could do to probably make it a market ready one, right? So so like I said, the three key things that a moderator looks for is, one, the facial expression, two, the tonality of the voice, and three, the actual content, right? So we thought if we could get a proper video of a focus group discussion, right, we'll get the video stream. From the video stream, we can figure out what the expressions and the faces of the people are, right? From the voice stream, we can figure out what is the tonality, right? Who are the participants? We could always split the number of participants, and we could say, this is the tonality of the participant from this time frame to this time frame. This is the tonality of participant two from this time frame to this time frame, right? We can get that in a timeline view. Similarly for the content as well, right? So the actual content that they are talking, we could do a text-to-speech, speech-to-text on the content, and then do a sentiment analysis on that, right? So this is a very high level a very high level view of our solution, right? So we gave in the video, which is of a focus group discussion, right? So this video goes in, and there's two streams, the video stream and the audio stream. In the video stream, so what happens in a video is that, so as all of you would definitely be aware, there is nothing called video analysis, right? Image analysis, and in a video it's just that you have 24 images, 24 or 29 images consisting of one video second, right? So so what we do is, in case of a discussion where a lot of people are involved, right, people does not always sit straight like this and talk. People move, right? Especially their heads move, right? It moves all around, right? So we need to figure out how many faces are there, and where are these faces located, right? So how we do that is we have put a face detection identifier, and we put a bounding box on each of the faces, right? After the video, we do a clustering of the bounding box locations. So we know that, okay, there are like five distinct clusters, which means that in the video, there are five faces, right? So that is the face detection part. Then we have the facial emotion detection. So we used the FER data set, which is the facial emotion recognition data set, which is trained on close to 15,000 images of people with five distinct expressions: happy, sad, anger, disgust, and normal, right? So based on this data set, we have created a neural network that would look at the face at each frame, not each second, in each frame, right? And figure out what is the expression at that particular frame is, right? That is again normalized to ensure that a person, like it's grouped, right? A person is happy, 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 and then neutral for like the next 10 frames. So that's like 5 frame neutral and 10 frames happy, right? Normalized like that. Now on the audio stream, so the first thing that we do is we extract the audio from the video, right? And then we need to do something called a speaker diarization. We need to figure out how many unique people are speaking, right? There are multiple ways to do that. We could always look at the silences that comes between two people speaking, but that might not always work in a focus group scenario, because there would be one person speaking and one other person can quickly cut him off, right? Or probably the moderator can interject, right? So we have used IBM Watson here for the speaker diarization part. So IBM Watson, we send the speaker, the speech input to IBM Watson, and it comes back with the speaker time frames, right? Speaker one spoke from first second to 10 seconds, speaker two spoke from 11 second to, like that we get the output from IBM. Then we do what is called a tonal analysis, right? So tonal analysis, again, we used IBM for tonal analysis. So IBM Watson speech services, so they figures out, given a speech input, IBM Watson gives us what is the tonality of that voice on a sentiment scale from 0 to 5, 0 being the saddest and 5 being the happiest, right? And we also have the sentiment analysis, right? Sentiment analysis as in between like say 5 second to 10 second, what is the sentiment analysis, what is the sentiment for the content spoken by each of the five participants, right? So at the end of this, you can visualize that we have three time series data frames. So one is the video stream with like five feature vectors consisting of the expressions of people at like in the time frame. Second, we have the tonality, same five distinct speakers. Same with the sentiments as well, right? Five distinct speakers for the whole time frame. Now we need to know, knowing the time frame was is not sufficient. Right? Just knowing that they were all generally sad between 10 second to 20 second is useless information. Unless we can say they were generally sad about the battery being low, or they were sad about the mileage being low in case of a car, right? So that is our fourth module. We do a topic modeling on the kind of textual data that we have, right? So we try to figure out what are the distinct features or topics being discussed. And based on these topics, we try to map it back to the time ranges so that we get a complete picture of what exactly happened, right? So between between 1 minute, first minute to second minute, people were talking about camera. The general sentiments was like high generally, but then there was this one key point that had negative sentiments, which talked about, say, optical image stabilization, right? Something like that. So those kinds of insights can be brought about, right? So the key thing here is the speaker identification. Now, if you think about it, from the audio stream, we have done speaker diarization, and both these parts, the tonal analysis part and the sentiment analysis part, works on the same data. So it knows who the speakers are correctly. But this is not in line with the data from the video stream, because that used an entirely different set of code, right? So in both these sets, we have five speakers, S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, and say S6, S7, S8, S9, and S10, right? So these maps to each other, right? The speaker who is known as S1 would be the same as the speaker S8 from the audio stream, right? So we did a correlation. We did a correlation in the entire time series to see which two speakers, right, the speaker from the video stream and from the audio stream, matches the most, right? There could obviously be exceptions, like a time when there was a sarcasm, or probably a person was speaking and suddenly he had a yawn. Probably the focus group discussion was also after lunch like this, so probably one person yawned. So there could be like misses here and there. But when you look at it from a time series, entire time series perspective, generally we see that it's always in alignment, right? With this, we come to the analytics engine, which looks at the data that we have and create a presentation or a report containing what is the general sentiment of on the product. Would the product be a success or not based on customer perceptions? And also, it can come up with insights like, hey, if you improve this particular feature, if you probably change the configuration from this to this, then it could potentially be a success, right? So this we have implemented, and we have implemented completely using open source technologies and IBM Watson. Python was primarily done for programming. Keras and TensorFlow was used for the emotion detection part. NLTK was used for the sentiment analysis and topic modeling part. And tonality was handled by IBM Watson, right? So this is a working deployment, and so this is pretty much what I had to say. But then, before I stop, I just want to run by two key things that was our learning from this, right? Or potential improvements from this, right? So one is on a very controlled scenario, once we have very good quality data, very good quality video, it all works perfectly, right? Because there's no noise in the data, we can clearly identify between five speakers or 10 speakers or whatever it is. And IBM Watson has a limitation that the tonal analysis module would work only for like five speakers at most, right? So that is one key challenge that we faced. Another challenge was around performance, right? So this first module, the facial emotion detection module, that, like I said, it's a convolutional neural network that is it has 9 layers. It was a little bit time consuming, right? So there were times when we ran it on our laptops, and a 10-second video would take any time between like 1 hour for completion, right? Then we had deployed it on a very powerful VM, and that is when we could actually get it working. All right, yeah, questions? Yes?
Argument, when two people are having heated argument and nobody is making any sense.
Hmm.
Nobody is making any sense of what people are speaking. How does this center thing work? Have you tried that? Because on certain things, people can become way too emotional and, you know, they can go bonkers.
Right, totally.
So, on those aspects, how does this entire tool work? Any insights on that?
Right. So one of the key tasks of a moderator is also to ensure that the discussion is moderated, right? So unfortunately, we cannot do that over here, right? Because the system cannot go back and say that, hey, you're going on the wrong direction, at least not in real time. So in an argument scenario, yes, it's a very valid point where the solution would break, right? So yeah, probably that is something that we'll keep in mind when we talk about the next iteration, when we think about the next iteration. So it looks like this is being a free focus group for me. Yay. Okay, anything else? Any other question? Yes. So the thing with sarcasm is that you cannot always, even for human beings, right? If you cannot always conclusively say that, okay, this was sarcastic. There are times when we are like, was this sarcastic? I think so, right? So what happens here is that we have three modules here, right? The sentiments coming in from the facial thing, the tone thing, and the sentiment thing, right? So if all three are pointing in different directions, or probably two is on one direction and one is the other way around, then we assume that it is a sarcasm, right? It is sarcastic, right? But definitely there's a lot of improvements that we can do on that front. Especially sarcasm is a very key thing. In certain cultures, people, and also there's another scenario, right? So people tend to, if you are on a focus group, right? For example, Samsung has called you for a focus group. You are fed up with using a Samsung phone, okay? But then would you just go to them and say that, hey, I hate Samsung phones? We would never say that. We'll try to put it politely. I like Samsung phones, but then I've always felt that your configurations are not in alignment with the praise at which you are, the rate at which you're praising your product, right? So these kind of contradictions could also appear, right? So yeah, that's again another improvement that we can think about. I have time for one more question.
I just have a small question. So.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But as far as speech to text is based on the keywords, it assumes sentiment based on the keywords in the box.
That's right.
Exactly.
That's right.
So one person will use lot of keywords. Just you said when you want to be nicer, so you say Samsung is good at something, but you're lying on this. So when you look at the keywords, good is the better keyword. So mostly you get a wrong sentiment, right? So how are you handling that?
Yes. So that is where the power of triangulation comes in. So if you had just two. Yeah, so I'll just repeat. So the question was that the sentiment modules are usually based on the keywords, and if a person has politely put that your product is crap using very good keywords, right, how would the system would capture such a scenario, right? So what would happen in such a situation is that we have, again, three modules here. So rather than, so if you look at it, his face is like sad and he's talking good things, right? So that is an indicator that there's like a contradiction in two of the streams, right? So with three streams, we can say that we can probably have a better way of predicting that the person is not actually meaning what he said, right? It could be correct, it could be wrong, right? So yeah, that's also a potential point of improvement for us, right? So my time's up, thanks guys. Please meet me, I'll be around for some more time. We can talk more about this. Thanks everyone.